In recent years, tablets and e-readers have topped many holiday shopping lists. Jeffrey Brown looks at one program aimed at using that technology to get people to read.
More than 770 million people around the world are illiterate, according to UNESCO. The nonprofit organization Worldreader wants to decrease those numbers and eventually eradicate illiteracy for the next generation.
I will go on Friday after work and come back on Sunday.
The group distributes e-readers to individuals, classrooms, and libraries throughout Sub-Saharan Africa, where 50% of schools have few or no books. 3 years old, the program now reaches over 13,000 children in 9 different countries, including Kenya, Rwanda, Zimbabwe, and Ghana, where 15-year-old Rita Duke Stevens wants to be a lawyer when she grows up. She spoke in this Worldreader-produced YouTube video.
I think I have to read a lot to know about things and people so that in future I will be able to judge people's cases in a good way so that people won't suffer.
Once the e-readers are distributed, the organization curates a wireless library of local and international books. And joining me now is David Risher, the co-founder and president of Worldreader. He's a former executive with Microsoft and Amazon, and welcome to you.
Thank you, Jeff. It's great
you
to be
have
here.
Described, I've seen you describe your aha moment that led to this. Tell us.
We were traveling around the world and actually had spent some time in an orphanage in Ecuador. And at the end of the day, this was a girls' orphanage, I looked across the way at the woman who ran it and asked why there was a building with a big padlock on it. And the woman said to me, well, that's our library. And I said, well, what's going on? And she said, you know, the books take forever to get here. By the time they get here, they're often not even the books that our kids want to read anymore. And the girls really have sort of finished with what's in there. I asked, can I take a look inside? And she said, you know, David, I think I've lost the key. And it really was at that moment where I thought to myself, okay, hold on. I can either step back and think, okay, I'm just going to sort of watch the world not have the books they need to improve their lives, or I can sort of step into it and say, let's solve this problem.
Well, you were coming from this world yourself, right, of technology and e-books. How did you translate that knowledge? How does it work, actually, on the ground?
So we get e-readers, and we also use cell phones as well, but let's focus on e-readers for a second. From companies like Amazon. We load them up with international books and local books. One of the things we realized early on is it's very important to bring books to the kids that are going to inspire them and that the children are going to connect to.
And that means books from Africa and African writers.
That's right. African writers, African textbooks, African storybooks. You know, one of the first times I went to Ghana, which was the first country we operated in, I went to the back of the classroom and saw one of the paper books they had. I picked it off the shelf. And it was the history of Utah.
Shows the haphazard nature of what reaches them, right?
That's exactly it. I mean, it's almost landfill that sort of gets redistributed, you know, into Africa. And so we said, well, hold on. The world is favoring the digital distribution of books. And so if we can take electronic readers, put local books on there, and then have the kids read, they will read more, they will read better, and they will improve their lives as a result.
So here's an example. I mean, this is just your basic...
That's right.
E-reader?
That's exactly it. I mean, we decided to use some off-the-shelf hardware, you know, an e-reader. We put a case on it, we put a light on it, we put a skin around it. One of the earliest things that our kids asked us is, can we have a light so that we can read after dark? And it was that sort of, you know, observation that made us realize this really can work and it really can change the world.
The obvious issue, one obvious issue, is cost, right? It requires, I mean, to make this work, I assume you have to do it at as the lowest cost possible.
You do. But that's a nice thing about technology. Technology gets cheaper every day. You know, these, which, you know, cost $400 a couple of years ago, these now cost $50, you know. And then the other cost is the books themselves. But we're lucky there, and we've worked very hard. We work with international publishers. You know, we've gone to Random House and said, look, can you contribute the use of the Magic Treehouse series to our program for free? And they've said yes. We've gone to Simon & Schuster and done the same thing with Hardy Boys. And then we go to African publishers and we say, we'd like to pay you a small amount, but we'll pay you for every book we use in our program. And for them, it's a great new way to sort of, to, frankly, as a revenue stream, and it's a way to get kids reading more, which, of course, is their goal, too.
And what kind of barriers, if any, have you hit along the way?
You know, it's interesting. I mean, the biggest barrier, and this will sound funny, is that the demand is so great that we have to struggle, frankly, to keep up with it. You know, we started 3 years ago with 50 kids in a classroom. We now, as you mentioned, have 12,000 children reading on e-readers. And so as a result, we've expanded our program to include cell phones, which is a device that so many people in the developing world have. You know, cell phones really have leapfrogged over the physical landline, and it's sort of what we're trying to do with books. So now we have another 150,000 kids reading on cell phones every month as well. And this is our biggest challenge, is how do we keep up with that demand, and how do we keep the funding going to sort of keep the whole program moving forward?
And of course, scaling up to have a real big impact, right? I mean, that's got to be the big issue for you.
So that's right. I mean, our goal, and we know this is ambitious and sort of crazy, but it's to eradicate illiteracy. So
you laugh as you say that. I mean, because it's so big, such a big goal?
That's it. But at the same time, it's a goal that, you know, not necessarily in our lifetime, but in our children's lifetime, we can achieve. Mm-hmm. You know, this is the sort of thing where you look back 100 years ago at what the Carnegies and the Rockefellers did, putting in infrastructure for books and education system. That was the analog world. That was the world paper-based. Now we can do the same thing digitally. It'll take some time, but we'll get it done.
But you're speaking, again, coming from the tech world, you're seeing the potential for technology as a... Well, this is real big social change, right?
Right. That's right. Yeah. And I think that this social change, you know, change happens in waves, right? And this technology, it's actually not the technology that's the most important part. It's the whole scale move towards digital, the whole scale move towards cell phone covers, and the whole scale move towards understanding how much knowledge matters to a society to help lift it up.
Okay, that's what it all that's is. That's big. Go back to the ground level or the school level.
Yeah.
You told me about the aha moment for you with the idea.
Yeah.
When was the aha moment where you saw that this could work?
I would say at first it was watching the kids in our first classroom in Ghana who were reading Curious George. And they were literally reading it word by word. And at the end they looked up and they said, "Can we have another book?" Mm-hmm. And we said, "Yeah." And we downloaded another book on their e-reader right then, and they started reading again. Now, you have to remember, these are kids that live in a world where there are no books, where it could take 6 months or a year to get their hands on a single book, and now all of a sudden they're walking around with a library that can hold an infinite number of books. That moment changed the world for me. Fast forward maybe a year, and I'm talking to Okanta Kate, who's one of the girls in our program in Ghana, who says, "Because I read The Shark by Peggy Opong, an African writer, I now want to be the most famous writer in the world," right? Or Mary in Tanzania, who's 10 years old, and she says, "I want to be a pilot when I grow up." She loves reading her atlas. "I want to be a pilot when I grow up so that I can fly to Bangladesh, the United States, and send money back to my mother so she can learn how to speak English." It's those sorts of moments that really make you think, okay, this can work.
Okay, David Risher of World Reader, thanks so much.
Thank you, Jeff. It's great to be here.